Hello, everyone. Welcome to my 28th MMA Diary. Almost getting near that big 3-0 there. Last week was International Fight Week, and the UFC Sioux Falls South Dakota card. And I can't show you my picks because my Xbox will not connect to the internet. I can, you know, go online with my PlayStation 4, but when it comes to Xbox, it just completely doesn't work. I tried reconnecting my wireless network. It shows I have a friend online. See, I have a friend online. Everything else is fine. It's just that I can't access anything on the internet. For some reason, I can see that he's online. But I have no clue. Doesn't matter. Let's get into it here, huh? So, UFC 200, TUF Finale, Season 23, I think? 24, I don't know. We had the same problem last time, didn't we? And then that South Dakota card. With the UFC, or with TUF Finale, how about that, huh? Joanna Jędrzejczyk versus Claudia Gadelha. Yep. So that card was pretty solid. Nothing amazing. I didn't take too many notes here for this card because, I don't know. For some reason, I thought I might remember everything that happened on the card. Whoop. But it turns out, no, I don't remember much. Sorry about that. Two with my predictions for this card, the Gray Maynard Fernando Bruno. Fernando Bruno, he didn't look that great. Gray Maynard, he looked pretty decent. I just picked against Maynard because I thought that guy was done. I mean, he was a legit dude when he fought Frankie Edgar those couple times there. But no, Maynard looked really good against Bruno. But Maynard also said that after the fight in his post-fight comments that he'd love to fight Frankie Edgar again. It's like, yo, Maynard, I know you're an athlete and you have to try and be confident, but Frankie Edgar just fought for the interim title. It's not like you stand that much of a chance. Got that one wrong. Jake Matthews versus Kevin Lee, I got that one wrong as well. I don't remember this fight much, honestly. I think Kevin Lee got a finish, but I cannot be sure. Anyways, yeah, I got that one wrong. Thiago Tavares versus Doohoo Choi. I got that one right. It sucks, though, because I went out of the room to open up a window in the bedroom, and my girlfriend starts screaming, like, oh my god, oh my god. And I'm like, shut up, because she usually does that kind of stuff to amazing happens when I leave the room. And I'm like, shut up. And she got really mad. It turns out that Doohoo Choi got a pretty amazing knockout. You know what? Let's just get up, huh? You want to don't need to mess around on the ground. Oh, shit. Sprawl, bitch. Yeah, Doohoo Choi got a pretty great knockout. Now why the hell do you do this stuff? Oh shit. Looking for the armbar, looking for the finish. Her arm's out of the submission. She's got the back now. Got the mount again. No, I don't need to do why, like, I don't understand it. Good elbow by Gadelha. Co-main event? I don't know if it was co-main. Finales were the co-main event. That one girl who won, she looks like she might be legit. Come on, block your fucking face, you dumbass. No, 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 no. Let's just get up, huh?
Back up again.
Sanchez, I think her name was? Can't be sure. Like I said, I don't pay attention to TUF, but that girl looked pretty goddamn dominant. She looked big for a 115 pounder too. Oh, hello. Whoa. Whoa. I'm out. That's a loss. That's a loss for your boy. Yeah, Ross Pearson versus Will Brooks. Will Brooks looks good. He looks impressive, but he didn't, do anything to amaze you, you know? But he put Pearson away. I forget how big his freaking legs are every time I see him. Like, goddamn, they're like tree trunks. And then the main event, Joanna Jacek versus Claudia Gadelha. I picked that as fight of the night. That was fight of the night. Claudia looked really good in the first two rounds, and I thought Joanna sort of busted her nose up, broke it, because Claudia was just having her mouth hanging open. She looked really gassed. I'm like, she must have her nose busted. She can't be in this bad a condition. But yeah, she was in that bad a condition. Joanna came back awesomely in the last three rounds and got that victory. I like Joanna Jędrzejczyk a lot. Jędrzejczyk. I like her a lot. Now let's go to UFC 200. UFC 200. I'm all like, that card was pretty fucking good. If it wasn't the most exciting card, I thought it was still really cool seeing all those big names. There was no boring fight on that card besides Sage Northcutt. I don't know why he was on that card, but they decided to put him on there. What can you say? But yeah, I really, really enjoyed the card. People are saying, oh, B minus, B, C, D. I give it an A. I give it an A. The yellow mat, the golden gloves. I thought everything about it was cool. Let's do. Misha Tate versus Amanda Nunes. And guess what, motherfuckers? I picked the right one, y'all. I picked the right one. I went 10-2 on this card. And the two that I got wrong, I'll own up and say that, yeah, I was pretty surprised that both of those guys lost. But we'll get to it in due time. I'm going to go over the full card here. Miller versus Gomi. Miller just dominated him the whole time. I took some notes, little really brief notes on these, but yeah, Miller just dominated him the whole time. I think Gomi's done. I mean, he's had a long career in MMA, from Pride to, I'm not sure if he was in any other organizations before he jumped over to UFC, but it's been here a long time. You think of one of his last was Joe Lozon. Stomping him and then walking away before the ref even stopped it. And then Miller just on top of him the whole time. Pretty dominant. Gegard Mousasi versus Thiago Santos. Gegard Mousasi looked fucking good. I kind of thought it might have been a dirty trick when Mousasi got up and the other guy was getting up. Because sometimes they back off and they're like, yo, get up. Like Joanna did to Claudia. She knocked her down or Claudia fell down or whatever, and Joanna was sort of standing over her, and then she walked away and get up, she just threw her arm up, get the fuck up. Mousasi didn't do anything as dramatic as that. He sort of got up and backed away a little bit, and Thiago got up a crouching position where his knees are sort of up by his face to get up, and Mousasi just came and BAM! Right down the middle, badass knockout. I like Mousasi. So yeah, I got those two right, and Diego Sanchez versus Joe Lozon. I had picked this as fight of the night, not fight of the night. Lozon, just straight killer. He was the first man to finish Diego Sanchez, which is amazing. I mean, Diego Sanchez has been around a long time. Tough One cast member. Tough One winner. Yeah. He's been around a long time. Diego Sanchez had, Joe Lozon's badass, but I was kind of surprised to see how Diego sort of just went down like that. I mean, that credit goes to Lozon, I guess, because we've never seen Diego Sanchez act like that before. So. Sage Northcutt versus Enrique Marin. Marin had him in a pretty good armbar. Pretty good. I thought that Sage did it out. He got the win. He did. He deserved the win, but I thought Marin was way closer to ever finishing Sage than Sage was to finishing Marin. So I was kind of like, that poor Marin dude. No one gave him a shot, and I didn't give him a shot. And, yeah, he almost eked it out. And so I felt kind of bad for him that he wasn't able to get it done. TJ Dillashaw versus Rafael Assuncao. TJ picked Assuncao apart pretty lopsided. I thought it would be a much closer fight than that. But, yeah, TJ, he's good. TJ's really good. I just wish that he'd have some more, like, killer instinct in him. Like, he just sort of picked him apart those three rounds. That's pretty much the complaints I have for most of these fights on this card, is that no one seemed to really want to finish. Apart from, obviously, Nunez and Cain. Oh my goodness. The next fight was the first fight I got wrong. Johnny Hendricks versus Kelvin Gastelum. I thought Hendricks would be coming out, be like, yo, I'm fucking hungry, I want this win, I fucking had two great fights with Robbie, he didn't beat George St. Pierre, but I thought he'd beat George St. Pierre. And then he get knocked the fuck, well, he missed weight against Tyron Woodley, that would have been a good fight. Well, I don't know if it would have anymore since he's had such trouble with everyone else. Oh, shit. Knock the fuck out. Come on now. Hendricks, the first round, he was just standing right in front of him. It was like, it was pathetic. Great movement on the ground. You're in half guard, you're all good there. And now she's got full mouth. She's attacking with an armbar here. And Kelvin Gastelum, good on him, man. He kept the pace up. Like, both of those guys nearly missed weight. This fucking ground game. Excellent movement on the ground here. Constantly moving, constantly staying busy. Round one complete. Yeah, Johnny just didn't look motivated. He just stood right in front of him in the first round. He sort of started coming back later, but he never really dinged him up too good. I think that weight cut's fucking him up big time. And, you know, he's a short guy. He's not necessarily... Well, I mean, look at Hector Lombard. He fought at 185. If he can fight at 185, I think Johnny Hendricks can, you know? I don't know. People are saying post-USADA he looks different, and you gotta say he does. I was really disappointed in Hendricks, so I thought we'd see a fucking killer coming out. But yeah, that was all the FS1 prelims were decisions, which was kind of a bummer, considering that all the fights and the fight pass card were finishes, so... I was expecting a night full of awesome finishes. Oh shit. Didn't work out that way. Kat Zingano versus Juliana Pena. That was a fun fight. I picked Pena. People. Kat's like fucking killer. Kat's awesome, but Juliana Pena's a beast. You can't look past Juliana Pena. Oh shit. Good shot. Very nice shots.
She's got the double underhooks. And she pummels under and out of double underhooks.
Come on, get that fucking tie clinch.
She's got her in the tie clinch.
Get that fucking tie clinch. God, fuck.
Nice hook in the clinch.
Get it! Yeah! No, just throw knees. Throw knees. Throw knees. I'm all tired and shit. Grappling match. Penny looked really good. Poor Cat. Like, she's been through a lot. But, you have to say that she looked good for coming back after a year. Like, she looked... She looked like she was hungry. God damn it.
Hip escape, nice hip escape.
But yeah, Juliana Pena, I think she made a case for a title shot. Damn it, Tate, just die. Damn it. Cain Velasquez vs. Travis Brown was pretty badass. Cain Velasquez came back as the Cain Velasquez of old and put on a show. Put on a show.
They battle in the clinch, looking for a dominant position. Throws to finish, Joe. Great job blocking the huge elbow. Round number two complete.
He looked like the Cain of old. It was pretty awesome. He's just a scary dude. He threw those heel kick or those spinning heel kicks, wheel kicks, whatever the hell they were. He threw him up at fucking Travis Brown, who's 6'7". Good lord, that was awesome. Like, I can't wait to see Cain fight. If he can just stay healthy. Like, I want to see him rematch for Doom. I don't care. I don't know if he necessarily deserves a title shot right after. I mean, you know, he came back and he fought Travis Brown. Travis Brown's sort of in the lower echelon, even though he was ranked pretty high. I gotta say, like, if Big Ben Rothwell and Travis Brown fought, I'd probably pick Big Ben. God, fuck. So I don't necessarily think he can, jump right into that title picture. That's right, bitch.
Nice inside leg kick.
Fuck you, huh?
And now she's stacking her. Vicious ground and pound by the challenger.
Stop the fight.
Wow, look at that.
That's it. That's it.
Tremendous TKO. Great stoppage by the referee.
After Cain versus Brown, we had Aldo versus Egger. Now, I have a few things to say about this fight. Everyone says, if you judge the fight by output, Frankie should have won. Frankie should have won that fight just based on output alone. If Frankie wouldn't have threw as many strikes as he did, there wouldn't have even been a fight. Well, guess what? Jose Aldo knew what the hell he was going to do. Frankie Edgar puts on a pace. He puts out a lot of shots, okay? It's not Jose Aldo's fault that he does that. He just game planned for it. He said, alright, you know what? In our last fight, he was coming forward the whole time. I'm going to sit back. I'm going to pick him apart. I'm going to throw less strikes. I'm going to not throw kicks because I don't want to get taken down. And I'm going to win this fight. I may not finish this fight, but I'm going to win this fight. And he totally won that fight. I had it 50-45. I thought he won every single round. Jose Aldo looked good. I don't care what people say. Are you kidding me? His striking was crisp and clean and powerful. He didn't throw a lot of punches, but did you see the fight after? Did you see the guys after the fight? Jose Aldo looked untouched. Frankie Edgar was a bloody mess. Give me a break. I'm sick of people just throwing defense out the window like it doesn't matter. Like, in a fight, the only thing that matters is how much you punch. No, it also matters how much you don't get hit. And Jose Aldo totally won that fight. I do not understand how people think Frankie won that fight at all. There, I said it. Jose Aldo, new interim featherweight title, belt holder. Maybe he'll fight Connor. I hope he fights Connor because I think Jose deserves that rematch, but who knows. Okay, we'll go to bantamweight here and we'll do the McDonald Lineker thing. Chris Holdsworth. John Lineker. Then we went to DC vs. Spider. Anderson Silva. Not a great fight at all, to say the least. It's the most boring fight on the card. And people, and MMA media members are all like, don't boo DC, don't boo DC. He didn't have, he was in a lose-lose situation. He got his pay cut in half. I do feel bad that he got his pay cut in half, by the way. That really sucks. John Jones really fucked him over. But there are three ways Daniel Cormier could have approached that fight. The first was the way he did. Just take him down, neutralize his striking, try and win the fight on the ground. Not a very popular way to fight, much less to get a win against one of the most beloved fighters of all time. The second way he could have fought him was that he could have simply just, you know, tried to go out there and finish him. Tried to go out there and just crush the hell out of Anderson Silva. Doesn't matter if it's on the feet, doesn't matter if it's on the ground, doesn't matter if it's in the clinch, whatever. Just go out there and try and kill that dude. He's on 2 days' notice. For months for this fight. Alright, just go out there and try and demolish him. Try and take advantage of the fact that he has not had any sparring, any training, any preparation for this fight, really, at all. You know, that way you get some fans. The third way, I'm trying to think of here, I had a third way. Okay, laid on him like he did. Stood in trade with him like he did. No. There's no third way. I just made that up. I made up that third way thing. But, okay, here's what I think I was thinking. He had nothing to lose. I mean, he had everything to lose. He did have everything to lose. One, he could have fought him the way he did, lose fans, which he probably did. I mean, people were booing the shit out of him. Two, he loses to the middleweight champion of the world. And the former middleweight champion, the dude who's in his 40s. A dude who's, you know, weighed in at 198 because he didn't have to cut weight for 205 because he wasn't even expecting to fight. But he could have totally won everyone's respect and admiration by going out there and knocking the shit out of Anderson Silva. I mean, I would have been like, he's a 40-year-old dude, and, you know, I expect this shit to happen, but he could have at least made it look good. Instead, it was just laying on him the whole time. I know Anderson Silva was holding him so that he couldn't strike. I understand that, you know. Part of it was Anderson Silva's fault, but I put way less blame on Anderson Silva than I do on Daniel Cormier. Anderson Silva didn't have any goddamn training, any preparation for this fight. I do not blame him for holding him on the ground. Otherwise, he would have been ground into a fucking mashed potato. Like, give me a break. Why you guys... I just don't like the way that they were sticking up for Daniel Cormier instead of, you know, calling him out on it, you know. Like, it's the smart thing to do. It's a smart way to win a fight if you just want to win a fight. If you want to earn some fans, if you want to, you know, put on a good show, go out there and try and fucking kill the dude. The next fight I got wrong, the only other fight I got wrong in the night was Brock Lesnar versus Mark Hunt. Brock Lesnar he implemented his game plan, and he did what he wanted to do. Mark Hunt was sort of laying back, trying to get that shot, trying to knock him out, and he let the fight slip away from him. People are saying, oh, he took a dive. Mark Hunt took a dive. No, I don't think so. I think Mark Hunt tried to put on a fucking awesome walk-off KO like he's so prone to do, and that he just ran out of time. He didn't have the opportunity. I mean, he touched him a few times, but nothing to ever put him away.
Oh, he caught him. Looking for the single. Oh, and down.
Shit.
Perfectly timed sweep. Watch out. Trying to lock in the choke.
Feel kind of bad for Mark Hunt. Oh, God. Damn it. He had nothing to lose, really. I mean, he had everything to lose, really. Brock Lesnar had nothing to lose. Mark Hunt, he could have made a big-ass name for himself. He could have been world-famous worldwide for the man who beat Brock Lesnar. Instead, he got laid on, and now people are accusing him of taking a dive. I felt real bad for him. But Brock Lesnar is a freak. Brock Lesnar is a freak.
Here's a nice shot, lands perfectly.
I give him a lot of credit.
And here's a clean shot that lands.
I thought that Brock looked kind of tired in the second. I thought Mark Hunt would be able to take care of him in the third. But no, Brock, you got it done. You got it done. And then the main event of the evening, Misha Tate versus Amanda Nunes. Nunes dominant. Dominant. I told you guys, Amanda Nunes, first round knockout. And it wasn't a first round knockout. It was a first round submission. Because she rocked her so bad that she was just able to take her back and choke her the fuck out, even though the choke wasn't even that great. Amanda Nunes starts out fast. Misha Tate sort of takes it easy. And comes back later in the fight. Ooh, up kicking you, fucker.
Nice inside leg kick by Lineker. Oh, and another powerful leg kick. He's looking to slow his opponent down. And he's down! Joe, he needs to be careful here. Back up to his feet again. McDonald with a big leg kick.
Ooh.
Caught him with a punch. Ooh. Joe, take a look at this. Leg kick.
Yeah, and so Misha Tate's your new bantamweight women's champion.
Very nice sweep.
The title has changed hands. And I think it's funny, the only woman to beat Rousey was fucking... the only person to beat Rousey was Holly. The only person to beat Holly was Misha. And then the only person to beat Kat before Juliana Pena was Rousey. Ah, whatever. I had a weird thought that night. I thought it was pretty funny. I can't remember it now. This episode sucks. I'm just sort of going off the cuff because I'm so pissed off about my goddamn Xbox not being able to connect to the internet. What? Oh, I thought I had it. Shit.
Moves in north south. In the clinch. They separate from the clinch. Big punch.
John Lineker's got to be very pleased. Ooh, hello. Like I said, I like 200 a lot. I have no problems with it. People complaining all the time, bitching about shit. No, it was a good fight. I mean, it was a good card. It wasn't the card everyone expected it to be, but it was a good card. 199, 198. I mean, 198 didn't really live up to the hype necessarily, but 199 lived up to the hype and then some, but I don't think it's fair to compare quality of cards, because 200 definitely had the highest quality cards. Okay, we'll go on to the UFC South Dakota fight. I only went 3-3 with this one, so that made for a good night of fights. A lot of upsets, a lot of surprise victories, good stuff. First off, we need more Joe Martinez in our lives. Oh, dude, 200. Bruce Buffer tore his ACL up because he was lip singing. He was trying to lip sync or something. It was like a big contest, and he got so into it that he fucking tore his ACL. What a loser! No, but seriously, Bruce Buffer had some pretty badass suit coats and everything, and he's toughed it out. He toughed it out in there, wobbling, him hobbling in and out, standing stationary in his introductions. Bruce Buffer 360 spin here. But Joe Martinez, he's smooth. Like, that dude's good. WEC guy. So, first fight that I picked was Spicely versus Alvey. I guess Spicely was from the tough season, but Alvey looked good, got it done. And then his celebration is just awesome. His whole posing and everything was great. Oh yeah, Courtney Casey versus that Romanian. God damn, I forget her name now. Let me check here. I think I got it written somewhere. Wait a second. No. Let me just look. Somewhere around here. Let me just look. Okay, let's get out of here, huh? Let's quit. Christina Stanchu, that's it. Christina Stanchu. I remember Christina Stanchu fought Marina Moroz. I remember her when I saw her. So, she was actually a pretty good fight there. And Courtney Casey, I remember her fighting Miho Sam. She's a good fighter. But yeah, Courtney Casey looked legit, got shit done. Pretty exciting. We'll just do this for the shits and giggles so I can just get through the rest of this. Yeah, so good for her. Lauren Murphy versus Caitlin Chukugin. Never heard of Caitlin Chukugin before. Chukugin. Something like that. But she looked really sharp against a really tough girl in Lauren Murphy. She kind of looked like Holly Holm, and that's kind of with her striking, the way she just sort of picked apart. But she never really tried to finish, at least as far as I could see. She just sort of wanted to win on points from what it looked like to me. And Lauren Murphy, she tried getting her down, ground and pounding her. Only really happened for her in the second round. But yeah, I got that fight wrong there. Louis Smoka versus Ben Nagin. Round one was amazing. That was such a good round one, So just jujitsu all over the place, just sliding in and out, transitioning, sweeping. It was really, really good. Like, Louis Smolka is a beast, and in the second round he was able to get the finish. I was gonna pick this as fight of the night, but I didn't. I picked the main event as fight of the night, and I was wrong. This wasn't necessarily fight of the night, but it was right there in contention. Beat the shit out of Josh Amon, really. I was really surprised. Good for Boach. He's a freaking veteran. Co-main event, Tony Ferguson versus Lando Vannata. Holy shit. That round one was one of the most entertaining round ones ever that I remember seeing. Maybe not. Maybe that's
bit of hyperbole there. It was definitely the most surprising round one I've ever seen. Like, I gave Lando Venata zero chance against a beast like Tony Ferguson. And Lando stood in there, traded back and forth throughout round one. Round two, he was eating shots, and then he finally got put away. But, oh man, that head kick Lando landed on Ferguson, where Ferguson's wobbling all over the cage. Ferguson just grabs onto his leg like a dog on a soup bone. It was so good. That was such a good fight. I was really impressed by Tony Ferguson being able to stay in there after that. He ate some big shots. But Lando Venata, his chin just looked like granite, man. That guy was badass. And then Tony got him in the darts, choked him the hell out. Fucking awesome. I'm really excited to see Lando Venata fight again. And Tony Ferguson, I would put him and Eddie Alvarez in a title fight. Then I do Khabib and RDA co-main event, co-main event number one contender match. Unless you just want to send RDA to the back of the line, which I can understand, but I don't think you should square off Ferguson and Khabib again, because it just doesn't seem like it's going to happen. Give that a little break. Maybe wait for one of them to be a champion before they get that fight scheduled again. But who knows? In the main events of the evening, I got that one wrong as well. I picked Michael McDonald. Ended up being John Lineker. One question I have for Michael McDonald is, why did you just decide to stand and trade with him? Like, that was obviously the worst thing you could do. Like, John Lineker has freaking stone hands, just smashes people. Michael McDonald did pretty good. I mean, he ate a lot of... He hit Lineker with a lot of clean shots. But, as soon as John Lineker got into range, he just dropped McDonald like five or six times. McDonald's all over the ring, just falling, getting back up. Pretty entertaining fight. Pretty awesome card. Like, really good entertainment value. And it had got like the lowest ratings of the year for UFC on FS1, which is sad. But my boss, he forgot that it was on. I was going to remind him, I forgot to remind him because I almost forgot too, but then I remembered. Watched it. I'm sure a lot of people forgot. They're all like, shit, there was a fucking card on Wednesday. It's just weird that you have it in the middle of the week. If this was on Saturday, I might have gone to it, but, you know, who knows. It's just a bummer. Okay, here's some news and notes for you. Dan Hendo Henderson fighting Michael Bisping for the middleweight title in the fall sometime. They're going to try and fight in London. Or in England, I mean. I don't have a terrible problem with it. People are all like, what the hell is the point of ratings? Like, rankings, if we're just going to give the 13 guy a shot at the title. And I'm thinking to myself, like, Michael Bisping versus who is really going to sell a card? Your boy Luke Rockhold, he just got beat. Michael McDonald, Chris Weidman, you know, he's badass, but he's coming off a neck surgery, and he's coming off a loss. Michael Bisping versus Chris Weidman would be alright, but I don't know. I just think the easiest fight to sell here is goddamn Bisping versus Henderson, right? It's the easiest one to sell. And that's what we're in the business of here, you know? UFC is about selling pay-per-views, getting money. Jacare, Souza, Yoel Romero, those guys don't have name value. Like, people who bought 200, they don't know who Yoel Romero and Jacare Souza are. They might have remembered hearing about Chris Weidman beating Anderson Silva, but he's not a Bellator anymore, and Anderson Silva's lost almost every fight since he fought Weidman, except for that Nick Diaz fight. I don't have a problem with it. The rankings are there to sell fights, if we're being honest. I mean, they kind of represent the real order of things. They're to sell fights, you know? I don't have a problem with it. I'm excited for it. I like it. It's a good fight. It's a good fight. Dun Hoon Kim is out of UFC 202. Lorenz Larkin steps in versus Neil Magny. I like that fight a lot. That's a good fight and not as good as Kim versus Magny, but Lorenz Larkin's no slouch. Ross Pearson steps in for somebody, I forget who, to fight Jorge Masvidal at 170 pounds at UFC 201. So Ross Pearson's fighting an awful lot this year. And he just fought, you know, July, what was that, 8th? And now he's going to be fighting July 31st. July 30th. So, good for him. But, I mean, that's a really quick turnaround, and he got beat pretty good by Brooks. So, Jorge Masvidal's awesome. I always pick Masvidal, and he always loses. God damn, I like Jorge Masvidal. I hope they don't cut him if he loses to Pearson. And a fight announcement here, Uriah Faber versus Jimmy Rivera at 203. UFC 203. Kind of a whatever fight. But 203 is looking pretty good, I think. What's no? Yeah, 203. That Ohio card. That's looking pretty decent. And then the big news of the week is UFC sells for $4 billion to WME, Whalen Mutual Exceptions. I don't know. I forgot what that stands for. Every time I hear what it stands for, I always think of Whalen Utani from Alien. It's something like that. I have no clue, really. I don't think it's going to make that big of a difference. That's what I'm hoping. But I started thinking about it, and I'm like, man, this might really suck. But if they're smart, they're not going to change a whole lot. So, yeah. New era of the UFC, new era for MMA. Finally, to wrap this show up, we are going to go over Bellator 158. This seems like it's a card from hell, honestly. Like, a lot of fights were announced, then a lot of fights were canceled, then a lot of fights were altered. It's pretty bad. Like, the main event here is Paul Daly versus Douglas Lima. Originally, it was supposed to be fucking, What's his face? Josh Koscheck versus Daly, but that fight just cannot seem to be get done. And then we were supposed to have Kimbo versus, I forget the dude he was gonna fight. Then Kimbo, obviously, he passed away, so that fight's off the card. Then it was supposed to be Francis Carmon versus That crazy, crazy guy. That crazy light heavyweight. What the hell is that guy's name? He's the insane one. I forget his name. And wasn't Vassal supposed to be on this card too? I have no idea. That fight's off. Francis Carmon's still on the card, but he's fighting someone named Lucas Klinger. MVP Michael Venom Page, his opponent bowed out, so now he's fighting Cyborg Santos. And now Matt Mitrione fighting on a month's notice, or fighting on less than a month after his last fight, takes on Ollie Thompson, who I guess is supposed to be some like legit British prospect dude. So let's see here. The 36-year-old from East Sussex in the United Kingdom is massively strong. That's what Bleacher Report says. So, I don't really have predictions, honestly, because I don't really know much of these dudes. I just know that the card has gone through a lot of shit. And it's not even going to air live. It's not going to air live. They're going to air it on like they did with that Breakfast with Fedor Risen thing, which is just retarded. Really bad. Douglas Lima versus Paul Daly. I'm going to pick Daly. But, I'll pick Daly. He's got power in his hands, but I think Lima's a much bigger dude, even for the weight class. Matt Mitrione versus Ollie Thompson. I have no clue. I guess Mitrione, because Mitrione's definitely got the name value, but I guess Thompson's supposed to be some local favorite, dude. And then
Michael Venom Page versus Cyborg Santos. I'm going with MVP because MVP is awesome. He's like one of the greatest. Nah, not one of the greatest. He's one of the most exciting. How about that? Here's a perfect head kick. That's all I got for you. Hope you enjoyed it. I'll see you next time. Here we see a beautifully timed kick. Wait, no. Nope. Did I scare you? Fight of the week. I almost forgot fight of the week. I was literally an inch away from clicking that button. Fight of the week this week is Dan Henderson versus Wanderlei Silva at Pride 12. Very, 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 very impressive fight from one of those guys. I'll let you figure out who that is, but that was it was scary, that fight. It was very scary. So, there you go. That's it. Now it's over for real. Thank you for watching. And we'll be back next week to preview Fox 21. I might go to that card if I can talk my girlfriend into it. It's like a 5-hour drive to Chicago. So, I'll be driving all night back because I ain't going to book a hotel room. I'll see you next time. Thanks for watching. Bye.